Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today. In the next iteration of the series that we're calling our Partnership and Collaboration Series with our friend and fellow Comprehensive Cancer Control professional, Jennifer Redmond Knight. My name is Kelly Sittig. I'm the Executive Director here at the Iowa Cancer Consortium. It is my absolute pleasure to be able to introduce to you Dr. Jennifer Redmond Knight, who I know will be familiar to many of you. We are so lucky to have been able to benefit from her expertise and insight this year through this webinar series. Dr. Redmond Knight is a facilitator and public health professional who helps leaders responsible for coalitions like ours, partnerships, and teams figure out how to get people to work better together so that they can make a greater impact together than they could on their own. She does this through her consulting business, as well as her role as an assistant professor at the University of Kentucky College of Public Health and a member of the University of Kentucky Markey Cancer Center Cancer Control Program. She serves as a co-principal investigator for the Kentucky Cancer Consortium, co-principal investigator for the implementation of quality lung cancer screening component of Kentucky LEADS, and principal investigator for a self-made health network grant focused on lung cancer health equity among predominantly male work sites. Dr. Knight has her BA in communications from Ouachita Baptist University, Arkadelphia, Arkansas, an MPH in epidemiology from the University of Kentucky College of Public Health in Lexington, and a Doctor of Public Health in Health Services Management from the University of Kentucky College of Public Health. Jennifer, welcome back, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Kelly. I'm so glad to be back, and hopefully this will be of great benefit. I know when we did our first kind of online meeting facilitation tips and tricks, we really talked about engagement and getting people involved in these meetings. And this one is going to get really down to some of the technology. How do we get it to work for us and not against us? So Kelly, as you know, a month ago or so, or a little more than a month, you and I were participating on a webinar related to empowering leadership. And it was an example that I'd like to use that was not the way we would want to do a webinar for several different reasons. And it made us quite uncomfortable, really related to the technology in many ways. The platform itself was confusing. It was hard to see where to push buttons and what it would do. And if the screen would move, how do you get it back? We had trouble to get our videos to work. It would only work if you had a certain role and you had to adjust different things. It was really awkward. There was another speaker who was running late and her video never worked and her sound was in and out. We, again, when clicking on different screens, it was like, oh no, how do I get back? And then sometimes I thought the mute button was off, but it was on. Ah, so I don't know about you guys, but having that experience can be really unsettling. And so figuring out how do we overcome that? What do you do in those situations is part of what we're going to talk about. Remaining calm is key and being flexible is also key. So let's get into what really works as a follow-up from our part one online meeting facilitation tips and tricks. Let's see. Let me advance my slides correctly. So as we think about what works, as a reminder, the first one, we clarified our purpose, we engaged people, and we're productive, but now nuts and bolts of really making it work. So here are some things that I have found really do work. Two of those important components are IT support and having Wi-Fi. So I'm gonna start out with those. There are lots of different tools out there, but one of the best tools that you can really utilize is gonna be having people supporting you. And you may not always have IT support on hand. As a matter of fact, I just discovered Best Buy is providing some stuff at home. So if you don't have the kind of stuff, at, people at work to support you, then know that there may be other places that you can get some support at a pretty decent cost. But as I say, having somebody on site or even on staff is critical in terms of making things work smoothly. I actually work remotely for the University of Kentucky, and yet we have a staff person that is able to support me in webinars and conference calls and things like that, who has been tremendous having that person kind of on site And it really reduces stress, knowing that if something goes wrong, you've got somebody kind of in the background helping things move forward, also helping record what's going on and things like that. And next piece that's so critical in terms of what works is going to be Wi-Fi. It is so important to have a steady, strong connection in order to particularly do video-related webinars. If you're going to have video, it's critical. If you're going to have audio, it's still going to be important. What I've learned, again, from my IT guru, everything I learned about technology, I learned from him, is that if you have a bad connection or an unsteady connection, the software will compensate. So it'll cut the video out altogether. It may cut audio in and out. So again, the Wi-Fi piece is going to be really important in that place. And so if you're not sure about your Wi-Fi, one of the things you can do is have, again, your IT person help you test your Wi-Fi. See what that connection looks like. It really makes a big difference in knowing that you have that support. And then the other piece is it's important to communicate with fellow presenters about their Wi-Fi. You know, one of the things we experienced in the webinar that I mentioned earlier is that that third speaker was in a shared free Wi-Fi situation that was not going to at all have a strong enough connection to host her video. So again, know where you're going to be. If you're going to be in a different place than you usually are, test that out ahead of time to make sure you have the kind of connection that you need to make these things work. The next piece of what works, I'm going to highlight a little bit about software as well as cameras. So from the software side of things, Zoom, which we're using now and you guys have experienced well, I've found to be really, really good. I think it has the fewest glitches of all. It's the most computer neutral. So I often work on a Mac. Most of my colleagues are on a PC, and some software tools really favor one or the other. Zoom tends to be pretty neutral in terms of that. And it also is just user-friendly and it's intuitive. I mean, I've tried Adobe Connect and WebEx and Linux and oh my goodness, Google Hangout, Skype, you name it, and you probably have too. And I've found a lot of glitches with those. So I would highly recommend Zoom if you're able to get an account yourself, or maybe partner with the Iowa Cancer Consortium for theirs as well. And as it comes to cameras, I would just say use your built-in camera, which often is available on a laptop. Or a Logitech camera tends to be pretty good. And again, this advice from my IT guru, he has had great experience. And so I'm just going to pass that along to you. There's a lot of different types of the cameras within Logitech, and all of them seem to work pretty well. They function often as a USB port. So you plug it into your USB drive, and then you stick your camera on top of your monitor if you have a desktop, is generally how that works. And so those are kind of some tips on that. The other thing that works, headsets. You know, it may be that you purchase a headset. Again, Logitech has some good headsets. One particular one is the H650E, as in Edward, headset. That's one that works pretty well. The other piece that you may even be successful in, and I've actually found success, is because I think I have a good microphone on my computer itself, that I can even use my my iPhone headphones and, you know, and microphone, which you would think, gosh, that should be, you know, pretty basic. It's not going to work. It's worked pretty well for me in several different settings. And so you don't always have to go high tech on that. You can use something that you may already have. Kind of following up on that are microphones. And again, those may be built in your computer, or they may be built in the headset, or they may be built in the camera. So an external camera that I've not actually needed to use, but I had as in one of my projects, it had the camera attached, and it also had a microphone, kind of speakerphone connected to it. So again, those can be connected, but it's important. You do need a microphone of some sort. What I have found is if people call in, even though you want to have a call-in option, which can work, that sometimes the call-in piece isn't as clear as the digital. So again, the digital will come from the microphone in your computer. So I would highly recommend you provide something or in your headset that comes there. So recognizing that there's going to be differences, whenever you do webinars, whenever you do meetings with people all over a different place, folks are going to have different Wi-Fi, different audio, different video. What do you do with that? I think one, the first piece is critical to recognize it. So similar to what we learned in even the emotional intelligence webinar series that we did early on, just that awareness of that there are differences, pay attention to that. And then really utilize, again, those emotional intelligence skills to be able to navigate and pay attention and recognize those differences and communicate assurance to folks that that's okay if they're in different places and they may have different things. And so again, I think that's one critical piece as we start out. And now there's a few specific things that we'll go into depth in each of these. And I kind of started out, but you're going to want to recognize the differences, assume the best, and engage those you cannot see. And I'll go into details, but basically one of the first things you're going to want to do is take notes that who's there so you can engage and you can recognize that some people you're going to see and some people you're not. And so kind of that's a big first step. What I will say, and I've experienced doing these webinars and video chats, I mean, every week I'm in multiple ones, particularly because I often work off site. And there are some people that, although you can be in person and everybody sees everybody in person, when it comes to doing something with video, it makes some folks really uncomfortable. They don't want to see themselves on the screen, and in part because they can see themselves on the screen as well. If they can't see themselves, they feel a little more comfortable. But when you're doing a video chat, some folks are just uncomfortable about being seen. And so I think one of the things is to reassure them that that's okay. They may not get comfortable, and so you may not be able to see them, but you can perhaps encourage, especially in a smaller group setting, to say, you know what, we're all here. Hey, I may be wearing yoga pants, or somebody else may say, I didn't wear makeup today, or whatever that may look like to help folks feel a little more comfortable. And again, in a small setting, it may be something that they're saying, okay, there's just three or four of us in this meeting. Maybe I will show my camera so that we can see each other. It helps with engagement tremendously, as we talked about in the first one. But again, sometimes people are not going to be comfortable, and you don't want to force people into that. Eventually, maybe as they see other people participating, they will. So going into depth here, I've kind of already highlighted this, but to focus in, you're going to have some on video, some in audio. Recognize that there are differences, but also recognize that you want everybody to participate, even if they're on audio only. We still want them to participate. And one of the things too is sometimes if people don't have a camera or even if they don't have a microphone in their computer, they can still join the webinar and they can call in. So they can see the slides by joining the link on the webinar, even though they may not participate through the webinar, but they can call in so that you can still hear them and engage in that. But then you can also allow them to see the slides and participate in what else is going on so they can at least participate that way. But again, recognizing those differences, highlight those and assure people you want them to participate. And again, assurance that it's okay if they have video or audio. You're not going to leave people out because of it. And that's something that you're going to want to be intentional about. And we'll get into that in this next section. So assume the best. I know it can be really nerve-wracking that you can't see everybody else on the video chat, particularly on a webinar like this. I can't see anybody else. But in terms of this, when you have a video chat, you may have three or four people that you can see and the rest that you can't see. So what my encouragement to you is to focus in on those you can see and assume the best among all of them. And so, you know, in that, the positive piece, be positive. Say, okay, I'm going to assume that people are glad to be here, that we're doing well. If I get some frowny faces in terms of what's going on in the people I can see, then I may ask some questions and redirect and figure out what may be missing or what may be confusing. And then the next piece is to stay productive. So again, keep moving things forward, assuming the best is going on, and that helps you kind of move things forward. If you're wondering, gosh, are people upset with me or is this not working out? Then that can really be distracting in terms of moving forward your agenda and your engagement with people. So keep that moving and don't let the fear of what you can't see derail you. Just focus on that, what you can see and the positive feedback you are getting. And then again, pay attention to what's going on, whether you can see those folks or not. Listen to the voices when those voices are speaking. Use the chat feature if you can. You know, I think that can be really helpful. A lot of folks not only don't want to be seen anymore, but they also really, you know, oh, I'm sorry. I clicked on one, two, many things. But they also don't always want to be heard anymore. What I have found from a chat perspective is that people are feeling more and more comfortable not being seen and using the chat feature. And so you can kind of encourage that, and you can hear comments, and you can engage people and pay attention to what might be going on. And I'll get into, like, in some ways, how do you get help from other people, because you need other help to be on, if you're facilitating this discussion in a webinar or a video chat or a meeting in an online place, then you're going to need some backup help, somebody else monitoring that chat perhaps and calling you out to encourage you to participate, or again, somebody else helping take notes and notice things that are going on. So you kind of have multiple people involved, but ultimately to move forward in a productive way when you have differences in technology, assuming the best is a great way to go. And then the last piece in this is to really try to engage those you cannot see. As I said in the beginning of this section, know who's in the meeting. Take notes either on your screen or on a piece of paper, and actually almost preferably on a piece of paper as well, so that this next piece you can pay attention to who is participating. You can almost put a little check mark, honestly, to say, did you hear from such and such and so and so? Oh, yes, they chimed in, or I've had radio silence from certain people. So I think that can be really helpful as well. And then again, I've, you know, mentioned this in the online meeting part one, is to call people by name to engage their participants, and particularly those not on video. Let them know, not in a scary way or punitive way, but say, you know, up front, I really want folks to be engaged. I'll be calling on you if I don't hear from you, because I want to hear your perspective. And so that can be really helpful at keeping everybody engaged, whether or not you can see them or not. And as I said, kind of earlier in this, is some of the reasons that people are not going to be seen on video is because they're uncomfortable with it. It's not as if they're trying to be difficult with you. They are just personally a little bit insecure and a little bit uncomfortable. So I would encourage you once again to reassure them that you would love to see them if they're willing, because it'll add to the engagement of the group, but you still want them to participate even if they're not willing, and let them be okay whichever direction they go. So anytime you're dealing with technology, online meetings, all those kind of things, there are going to be times it doesn't work. So what do you do when it doesn't work? You know, I know part of you may be thinking, I want to bail. Not quite yet. Don't give up so easily. But you know what? You may have done everything right. You have strong Wi-Fi. You have the right platform. You have all the technology, and still things don't work. I mean, you may have storms or a power outage. You may have intermittent connections. It just, stuff may happen, and you just never know what that's going to be. So even though you can't always expect what's going to happen, it is important to prepare for it. So here are some tips on what that looks like. So what I'm going to suggest is three different things, and we'll go into depth here on each of these as well. One, ask for help. And in many ways, ask for help ahead of time. Have people on point in terms of being able to help you. This can be IT support. This can be fellow staff, volunteers. Acknowledge it. Kind of say, ooh, we're having some trouble here. Hang in there, and we'll get to that as well. And then adjust as needed. Knowing that you're going to need to be flexible. And this is the case for any kind of meeting, really. But it's kind of more pronounced when you're online, because it's like, oh, it's not working. But you just need to make adjustments. So as we kind of go into these a little more in depth, ask for help. So as I've mentioned before, and I cannot emphasize it enough, become friends with your IT staff. And not just when everything's in crisis mode, help, you know, because they might start avoiding you if that's the only time you talk to them. But really see, hey, in preparation, could we try this out and test this out to see if this is going to work? Would you be willing to participate? How much advance notice do you need to be able to join us for our next meeting or our next webinar, our next conference call, and kind of get to know what that looks like? And then you know, ask for help ahead of time, saying, hey, if something goes wrong, what do you recommend we do? Talk to that IT person who is going to appreciate being respected and honored, probably, and use that expertise. Let them truly be the expert and listen to that expert. Ask for help from other staff or key volunteers. Again, it takes many people to support a meeting or a video chat or any of those things. It does the same in person. You've got some people maybe registering people, some people checking and handing handouts. Same thing for an online situation. Somebody else can be taking notes. Somebody can be managing the chat. Somebody can say, hey, would you go see if it's working for other people? Could you send some emails to some of our folks on site? Or could you make a few calls or text messages? Again, engage those folks. And I encourage you to do that ahead of time so they know to be ready a little bit early and a little bit after, just in case stuff is going on. And then also ask for help from the meeting participants. Say, hey, can you guys hear me now? Use the chat feature. You know, unmute the lines for a moment. Really let them have some feedback in terms of what is going on. And then, you know, have some feedback afterward too to say, hey, help me know how this went or how it could be improved. So then the next piece is acknowledging it. When things are not working, it's not good to hide it because everybody knows it. They're experiencing it. So I really recommend starting out with thanking participants for their patience. And there's something about that in a psychological way that when you thank people very genuinely for their patience, it helps them be more patient. I know I keep trying this with my 21-month-old. Thank you for listening, you know, and not in a derogatory way, but just in an encouragement to say, hey, let's be on the same page here. Let's come together here and let's appreciate one another. And recognizing we all may be in this situation at any given time. So if we are, wow, thank you for your patience because I'm going to be patient for you that next time. Again, those emotional intelligence skills come into play. The next piece is going to be remain calm and confident. Even though on the inside you may be going, ah, how am I going to do this? How am I going to move forward? It's completely falling apart. Somebody has put us on hold and I can't mute the lines and it's super loud or the slides aren't working or the speaker didn't show up and the video didn't work. It's okay. You know, remain calm and confident, at least on the outward appearance to folks and let them know you're working on figuring it out. The next piece is keep moving forward. Say that you are, you know, again, thank you for your patience and those kind of things. But some things you can adjust ahead of time. Maybe the slides aren't working, but you've printed out those slides ahead of time. So you can keep kind of talking through the content and saying, we will send those as a follow-up. Just keep it moving forward if that's possible. If it's not possible, just say, we need to pause. Give us 5 minutes to kind of work out the kinks, and then we will be back as soon as possible to make sure we're moving forward. Again, let them know what's happened, check in, and kind of back to that first piece, thank folks for their patience, and let them know that you appreciate that. So adjust as needed. So I'm going to suggest probably something completely obvious, but something that we sometimes get too busy to do, and that's create a backup plan. I know you're like, well, this is going to work. It's always worked for me in the past. Or no big deal, do I really have to print out those slides? It's worth doing. And usually when you have the backup plan, things go just swimmingly. When you don't have the backup plan, it's when things sometimes fall apart. So there's something about that backup plan that really almost helps things be ready. And that way you are also able to be more calm and confident if things don't work out. And again, kind of a big piece of that is going to be to print out your presentation or notes prior to the meeting. I actually did that today. I've got notes, I've got printouts, hopeful that all would be well, but it may not have been well. I sent them to Kelly and Tessa just in case something wouldn't work. But again, we never know when it comes day of if things are going to work as planned. So you've got to make those adjustments. The other piece is sometimes you really do need to reschedule. Sometimes it's, if you're having a video chat and it's very video focused, you have no slides and you're supposed to really talk with people and you need to see people to make this happen, then you may need to reschedule the meeting. Another piece is you may, even in your backup plans, may not have to reschedule, but you can say, let's move to conference call. Maybe you have a backup conference call line that if all web stuff goes out, the call will work and you can keep moving forward. That's fine. But maybe the content is such that you really need to share your screens to be productive. And so you need to reschedule. And that is okay. It's better to reschedule because it didn't work than to continue on and have it be just really poorly done in such a way that people may be hesitant to participate again. So sometimes that reschedule is the best thing to do when things just don't work as planned. So let me pause for just a few moments before I remind folks of what we've learned today and see if there are any questions that I can help answer.
Jennifer, there are no questions at this time so far, but if it's okay with you, I will put your email address in the chat box for everyone. And I know you said that if folks have questions after watching the webinar, they can reach out to either you or myself or another staff person at the consortium, and we'll see if we can get those answered.
Absolutely. That sounds great.
Thank you.
Let's do that. Okay, so keep your questions, and you may have them even later, so be sure to email me at that time. So, as a reminder, what works? I can't emphasize this enough. Befriend an IT guru to be your best friend as it comes to video chats and webinars and all those kind of things. Have good Wi-Fi. Strong, steady is incredibly important. Zoom software, again, as I've said, I've tried a bajillion of them. I feel like I've participated in many. Zoom really is the way to go for now. There is always new technology, though, so something new may come. Use Logitech products, and I hope that's how you pronounce it, but their cameras and headsets tend to be a really good resource. When there are differences in technology, it's okay. Recognize it and engage everyone, regardless of whether they're on video or audio. Assume the best, whether you can see folks or not. Know that they're on your side and just assume that things are going well. And when it doesn't work, ask for help from your IT, from your staff volunteers. Acknowledge the struggle. Recognize that it's difficult. Thank folks for their patience. And adjust expectations. Again, make adjustments in what's going on. Make adjustments in what needs to happen. Sometimes that even means rescheduling, as I said. But make adjustments and be ready with your backup plan as needed as well. So, some action steps for you today, I think, that could be really helpful. And you don't have to go into too much depth at this point, but I would encourage you guys to schedule 15 minutes before this Friday, or even on Friday, to develop a draft of your online meeting backup plan. So what kind of things do you want to include in your backup plan, kind of almost a checklist perhaps? And I'll be providing you guys a worksheet after this as well that's still in process, so it's not quite ready, but we'll have some ideas that you can include in that too, so you can go back and revisit. But are you going to include a conference call line? Are you going to always print out your slides? Who are your backup help people? Those kind of things to think about. And then I encourage you to visit my website, jredmondknight.com, for more ideas and suggestions that I include in my blog post. And also, if you want to sign up to get weekly updates when I post new blogs, I have actually a free resource, How to Lead Your Best Meeting Yet, that has some additional tips and tricks in that too. So thank you once again for the opportunity to be with you all, Iowa Cancer Consortium. And with that, I think we're good for today. Kelly, anything else to add?
No, except for thank you so much, Jennifer. We are really looking forward to continuing the series too with two more webinars that you'll be presenting. I put the link in the chat box so folks can register for those, and I'll re-enter that into the chat box. But thank you so much. We appreciate your time and hope you and everybody else has a great day today.
Thank you so much, Kelly.
Thank you.
Bye.